as concept develops, we look at that, and that's what we look at right now. It also has the lines of development, which we spoke to a lot. It also has states, which are recognizing that you can awaken state, or a sleeping state, or a tired state, or an inebriated state. These are just passive reality, which are rainy day, sunny day, which are states. And it also has types as other types of realities. So feminine types, there are different types of business models, there are different types of economic systems, there are different types of organizational structures, there are different astrological types. So we're not going to go into all of the different elements of integral theory today. What I want to do is just give you a taste into a follow-up paper that if you're interested in and really want to walk through those things. What I want to talk about right now is one of the most powerful aspects of an integral approach to leadership and conscious leadership for sustainability, and that's developmentally appropriate communications. And so what does developmentally appropriate communications mean? It means essentially communicating in a way that I deeply resonate with the way that you see the world. And that requires a fair amount of me listening and understanding and then tailoring my communication such that it really works with you and what's important to you. So whether I'm in West Africa doing work with a cocoa farmer who has 12 children and only cares about making money, and we're trying to get him to do best agricultural practices to deal with the ecological impact of the work they're doing, there's a different type of communication than if I'm talking with a CEO who is a Christian conservative and is wanting to promote their particular form of evangelicism through their business. And that's a different type of communication than if I'm working with a Greenpeace activist who is essentially trying to do a large-scale intervention and bring together multi-stakeholder systems. And so the point is that as we develop, we essentially go through a deepening and a broadening in the way that we see the world. And I'll walk through some of this a little bit just to give you a taste of it. And again, there's a couple of nice follow-up papers that will really allow you to go much more deeply into this. So what I've got here essentially is a map of four different lines of consciousness and overall sort of altitude level there on the left. And so we're going to be focusing on four different stages of development along the way. And a nice way to think of this is that as one develops, it's like climbing a mountain. And so with each step up the mountain, we're able to see further. And as we choose different paths up the mountain, we ultimately are choosing to privilege different perspectives. But as we get higher and higher and higher and higher, more and more of the landscape in front of us becomes obvious. So what this means in really concrete terms for sustainability is that as we develop, we become more aware of the internal contractions that we're having in the moment when we're talking with the CEO that are getting in the way of us having interaction, or we become aware of the system dynamics they're having amongst the stakeholders that we're working with, where one of them is trying to pull a power play and the other one is being defensive. Or we become more able to tune into the different economic models that are being used and really learn about those and engage those and understand them cognitively. A lot of this growth which happens is really essentially being more sensitive to what's happening in the moment. So it means that you become more intuitive and are able to access that intuition in the moment more easily and use it in service of your initiative. It essentially means that you develop the capacity to manage conflict more effectively because you can take different perspectives more easily. So all sorts of really interesting capacities come up that very much need to conserve sustainability. So let's just look at, let me walk you through a different graphic here and give you a sense of it. So I'm going to briefly walk you through these kind of stages of development. This is a graphic that will walk us all the way up through seven different stages, just to give you kind of a visual of it, and then I'll talk about each one of these different ones. So these very, very early stages are really, as people develop, it's about being very instinctive and it's safety-driven. Newborns tend to have this. If 100,000 years ago, adult humans were mostly at this stage. It was really about feeding in survival bands and moved around and kind of herd-like behavior, and their movements were determined by weather and food and water. It's a very early time of essentially survival. And as we developed, we moved into a stage where essentially there was much more tribally based in a collective perspective, where there was some sort of chief or some sort of shaman. There were clans that emerged. There was a time of foraging, and really this is during the Paleolithic times, and these are times where the worldview was very magical, it was very animistic, and it was all about rituals and rites and taboos and superstitions. And the ways of the tribe were considered very, very sacred. And so, developmentally today, this tends to happen. People tend to go through the stage when they're 1 to 3 years old. So my daughter is very much into a magical worldview, and we can talk about fairies, and we can talk about exploring the world through the magic energies that are all around us. However, as we develop, there's this whole sort of, on a global scale, what emerged was this exploitive empires, which was a world of kind of feudal realms where the most powerful made the decisions. This is a very powerful period of time where it was, this is the beginning of early horticulture and organized hunting. And this is the time of pre-mythic power gods. So it's not our sort of classic gods that emerge, but those that are really about kind of aggression and this and conquest and survival. And so in healthy development, humans go through this stage 3 to 6 years old. It's a very egocentric time. It's before they can logically think about things. It's before they can effectively represent things in their minds. They're very impulsive, power-driven, kind of about instant gratification and living in and out. And unfortunately, some adults today actually get arrested in this stage, and so we see this showing up with a small percentage of adults. However, as adults tend to develop, there's a stage which emerges that's more where they embrace more of an authority structure, where things become black or white, right or wrong. There's really, it's about order and meaning and discipline and conforming and seeking belonging and finding kind of my group that represents my beliefs. It's patriotism and nationalism emerged in these times. And it's about, historically, it's first came about through kind of the Copper and Bronze Ages. And the rise of the gray of agrarians, sort of the discipline that was required to go out into the fields on a regular seasonal way and attend and grow. And so this is a time really of traditions and a worldview of where morality is important and absolutism and fundamentalism are essentially dominant in this particular worldview. In typical adult development, again, this is children 7 to 8 years old go through this stage. However, we also find that a fair percentage of the population of the planet actually gets arrested in this stage. And so because we have a lot of this actually, 7% of the population of the planet to date is actually holding this worldview or earlier than I just described. So it's only kind of in Western industrialized societies created social systems that really accelerate people's development very quickly. important when you're out there engaging around sustainability issues that you recognize that the world needs in the present. Again, you don't need to remember all this stuff. I'll send you some follow-up documents and go deeper into it. So after this stage, we just went through kind of a traditional stage where things are much more conventional for people. And then we had the rise of modernism. And this was the Iron Age and the Age of Enlightenment and the Industrial Revolution. And with that came this whole concept of strategy and enterprise and capitalism and democracy and the freeing of slaves. And all of these things emerged essentially through this particular worldview that developed on the planet. This is very much a worldview about science. Science is the God here. In the previous one, you know, it was God as Jesus, or as very strict Buddhism. And in this one, they're testing a large shift towards secularism, and where it's about the economy, about the market, about science. Those are the dominant things that are important. And materialism is big. Success and driving for success is huge in this particular field. And there's a shift beyond that as well to what's more of a postmodern way of seeing the world, which is very dominant here within the Netherlands. And this is one that really has more to do with social democracies and deep ecology and group decision making, and there's a focus on consensus, being very sensitive to human needs and feelings. There's a focus on really there's a quest for affectionate relations and developing powerful relationships. If human development goes along smoothly and is well supported along the way, adults can get to this stage anywhere from 15 to 21 years. And again, lots of people then slow their developmental process and are arrested at this stage until they get close to death. But this is a time of really sharing and caring and focusing on the egalitarian nature of what we do. It's a very, very powerful way of seeing the world, and it's increasingly complex. It sees the limits of modernism and sees the destruction that happened, and it brings an important sensitivity to the needs of the world. And so all of these worldviews are happening and are engaged in the people that we're, the stakeholders that we're working with around sustainability. And the more that we can be aware of them, the more that we can essentially tune into developing our sustainability programs such that they resonate with people with these different worldviews. So these final couple stages represent less than 5% of the population. And these are people that have dropped into a world that's much more world-centric. It's about universal compassion and essentially being able to. There's a quest here in this stage for synthesizing and connecting the dots and being able to draw together large groups of people and large programs in service of addressing large-scale global issues. You see essentially very advanced cognitive thinking show up on this stage. Intuition is a huge part in decision making this stage. And they're essentially the development of consciousness in this realm is really largely it's decentered from the individual ego, meaning that it's not just about me anymore, but people really aren't aware that they are connected on some level or another, or in some cases they realize that they are one with everything else around, so that engages their actions. So again, this is a short synthesis from developmental psychology, but the point is that there's a developmental trajectory here that we go through. And as humans develop, we essentially